to you for our program. We're broadcasting today for the first noon show from our new studios, hope you enjoy. And if you have a chance to be in front of a computer, by all means go to the network, accessibilitynetwork.com, and you can watch in. Today's show, we're going to talk with our guest in the second part of our program, Tracy McMillan. Many of you heard of her because of Rush Limbaugh's attack against her. We'll be inviting her on to talk about the relationship between food and quality of food we eat and social class and corporate dominance of the food supply. I'll also be sharing with her some of the ironies that I have found in my traveling around the world about how we force people around the world in these societies to actually eat the healthiest food and the wealthiest are able to afford the fast food. And that's from both the United States. Also today, I'll be doing a continuation of our original UNDA investigative reporting series, The Politics of Medicine, Part 2. Today, the FDA, companies, the big pharma, myself and Dr. Nancy Ashley, one of our scholars and residents on staff. Also today, an issue that we'll be asking you to listen to and share your thoughts. And this is about American exceptionalism. Well, that's what they call it. I'm going to be interested in what you call it after you hear the report that has been sent to me from one of our listeners, Steve Brown. Of course, the latest on health and nutrition and what we'll be doing every day while at least I'm in New York, in our studio, will be interspersing clips from important issues to tie in with the theme of what we're talking about. This, again, always with the latest on health and healing and always information from mainstream peer-reviewed journals. Now, why do I emphasize that? Our statistics show, and these are accurate statistics, they're different than Google Analytics, is that we had just yesterday 6,000 brand new listeners to this program. And we're getting that almost every single day. Hundreds of thousands of downloads of this program, just one program. But a lot of people don't know the background. They don't know that this program has been representing on Pacifica for 34 years every day, on the DEI, for example, for almost 30 years, and on Pacifica for 34 years. And all the other stuff that's occurred. They're saying, who's going on? Why should I listen? If you were to posit this position, two, let's say, positions. I'm interested in changing my diet. I've heard that raw foods are important, organic is better than non-organic, the juicing is good, that I should have about 40 to 50 grams of high-quality fiber. But there's these things that I'm hearing about called phytonutrients and chlorophyll. And that if I take these can help me either prevent conditions or that they will help reverse conditions. Of the 900,000 plus doctors in the United States, medical doctors, the high probability that what you will hear is this. That's all crappy, it's nonsense, there's no science to support any of that. Indeed, from their perspective, there is no argument. From our perspective, we're only using orthodox mainstream science. We have over 500,000 studies. You heard me right. 500,000 studies from peer-reviewed literature on the healing power, the chemistry, the benefits of natural and non-toxic nutrients and foods and juices. And I say that because I want people to have some confidence that when I'm sharing information, it is not pseudoscience, it is not doctor. There has been an ongoing degradation program by those in the mainstream who fear that there will be a breakout, a crossover of this information that you're hearing and watching today into the mainstream. And thus far, they've been pretty good at preventing it. We had one major breakout and breakthrough on PBS in 1998, and our program, Public Forever, became PBS's all-time single-person successful program in their history. That took them about a year to wake up to the fact that we had influenced so many people to change their buying habits to organic, eating properly, to get healthy. And then everywhere they stop that from entering in, we continue to have 28 additional programs, all of which are medically challenged, meaning they're reviewed for accuracy. and they have their own scholars, individuals who appear on our staff who use the best of it. And here's how it works. Bill Clinton, the current president, is now a vegan. And he is doing much better with his health, and I'm happy to see that. How did that happen? Well, it happened because of one physician, Dr. Newlands. I debated with Dr. Newlands against a group of physicians on PBS in the 1990s on national television about the importance of clinical diet and lifestyle. In the near future, I'll put that up on our program so you can watch and listen to it. Dr. Newlands, this is according to the Archives of Internal Medicine, which is the AMA's own publication, here's what it says, quote, "Red meat consumption and mortality," that is the title of the article. Quote, "Is red meat bad for you?" In a word, yes. In this issue, we describe the outcomes of more than 37,000 men from the Harvard Health Professionals Follow-Up Study and more than 83,000 women from the Harvard Nurses Study who were followed for almost 3 million person years. This is the first large-scale prospective longitudinal study showing that consuming both processed and unprocessed red meat, hot dogs, hamburgers, salami on pizzas, bologna, is associated with an increased risk of premature death from all causes as well as from cardiovascular disease and cancer. In a related study, by red meat consumption is associated with an increased risk of type 2 diabetes. Substitution of red meat for fish, protein, nuts, legumes, low-fat dairy products, and whole grains was associated with a significant lower risk of death. So, plant-based foods are rich in phytochemicals, bioflavonoids, and other substances that are protective. In other words, what we include in our diet is as important as what we exclude. So substituting healthier foods for red meat provides a double benefit to our health. So, mind you, now who's saying this? This is mainstream medicine. Now here's the rub. We have outstanding medical science from the longest running, most comprehensive study in American history on what you eat, how it impacts you, and yet, even though we had the study, it was done at Harvard, it was published in the Archives of Internal Medicine, the publication of the American Medical Association, it will not be accepted by mainstream medicine. Nor will it be accepted by mainstream media, nor will it be accepted by nurses, dietitians, or the average American. So the idea is if we find the truth to our problems, if we have positive solutions, then there's going to be this paradigm shift. But one day, as Marilyn Ferguson, a great author, and if you haven't read The Aquarian Conspiracy that she authored, it's one of my 10 most readable books. I've read many times, much like George Leonard's The Silent Threat, or Hitchcock Pepper's The Turning Point. These are seminal books. She hypothesized that when enough people become aware of the truth, the total consciousness of a mass of people shifts the paradigm into a new direction. I believe that's absolutely the opposite of what happens. I believe that is wishful thinking, but here's what I do believe. When enough empowered, independent thinking individuals see that the changes they have made work for them, are positive, then that empowered minority, 1%, 2%, even maybe as high as 5%, and remember, 5% of the American population is 16 million people. That's a lot of people. When they see that something works and they have challenged it, when they shift, then they motivate the rest of the public to become aware that that possibility is there for them if they ever choose to consider in the future. That doesn't mean that we're all going to get happy and healthy tomorrow, but it means that we no longer have to argue, is it controversial? Is it provable? Long ago, we have proven our case. The healthy power of vitamin C preventing colds and cancers, the healthy benefits of eating raw and juicy instead of tetracyclamine loaded meat, cooked products, or acrylamide loaded bagels and muffins and bread. We don't have to do any more science. The science is overwhelming. And remember this, The Clockbuster seems totally discredited with individuals who are really nothing more than spokespersons for the pharmaceutical industry hiding and doing their bidding. It's a front group. No matter what proof you provide, it will never be enough for a closed mind, or a mind that refuses to change, or is lazy, or is locked into their comforts. They don't want to give up their comforts, even if the consequence is lung cancer from smoking, or alcoholic living, cirrhosis for the liver of those who drink, or premature aging for those who, as this shows, ate meat. So no longer do we have to prove anything to anyone. Just live your life as you see fit, and let the cynics be cynical. So President Clinton is alive today because he listened to a mainstream, board-certified physician who was a lone voice for decades being honored. In my opinion, he's an American hero. Now, on to other things. I suggest that you have at least 2 to 3 servings of berries a day. A serving is a cup, unless you juice it, in which case you'll probably have to juice a quart of berries to get maybe 4 or 5 ounces a day. The juice might even should be combinations like raspberry, black raspberry, blueberry, cherries, pomegranate, which you can get. You can get a container of pomegranate seeds and they're delicious, eaten into a dish or juice. Because they actually have the capacity to reverse DNA damage. Literally change the outcome of the future of your cells. So it is no longer inevitable that because you have made mistakes and now they've accumulated into a tipping point that you will be a victim of that. The good news is we're reversing multiple sclerosis and Parkinson's to a measurable degree, more so than anything in orthodox medicine. They're using expensive drugs, billions of dollars in grants. We're using berries and vegetables, inexpensive and easy to apply techniques of lifestyle modification. Here's the irony. We have confused the solution with the complexity of the problem. They say we're the official institute, give us billions of dollars, don't question the fact that we never have any good results. We'll keep promising the results if we never deliver, but don't look anywhere else. And we're saying we don't need any money, we don't need any additional research. Cause and effect. Those people who live a healthier lifespan don't get Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, cancers at the same rate as anyone else. And when you really apply nutritional, functional protocols, you actually reverse these conditions measurably. If they have official medicine, official science, official government protection, and official advocacy on their side, we don't, but we don't need them anymore. Because now, don't look at the official institutions for your proofs, you're not going to find them. Here's the latest on why you should be in your berries. Again, from the International Journal of Obesity, this was a major study. Quote, 24 million Americans suffer from diabetes, another 57 million with pre-diabetes will become diabetic. I don't care how you cut it, you're looking at almost 75 to 80 million Americans who either are pre or going to be diabetic, which case you're most susceptible to heart attacks, cancers, depression, dementia. Is what our focus verbatim. A special blueberry drink, that's meaning juices of blueberry, with bacteria that naturally occur on the fruit skin, provides an effective prevention and development of obesity, diabetes, and these medicines to increase those conditions. The company is in Montreal, company is through this online patio, and then we visit Montreal. It's called a biotransform.
From juices where you take probiotics, non-dairy probiotics, that help reestablish healthy bacteria in our gut, and you add in phytonutrients, let's say from blueberries in this case, or wild blueberries in this case, and you blend the two together, and when you drink that, that's really super healthy. But you could do the same thing with raspberries and strawberries, papaya, and that's a great juice to have each morning because fresh organic papaya concentrate helps the body turn off inflammation. It helps digestion. If you're having a problem with digestion, what better way to help yourself than with the papaya? And if you're having a problem with inflammation, arthritis pain, fibromyalgia pain, how about taking the core of pineapple? And guess what? For the first time, I actually saw a supermarket selling the core of pineapple. They wouldn't do that if they didn't know there was a market for it. People were asking for it. I hear that there's a bromelain in which is a very powerful anti-inflammatory nutrient in the core of pineapple. That is correct. Now you get a whole bunch, a whole quart. I think it was for about $2. That is terrific. So that's that. So get your pineapple core and take that each day, maybe 3 or 4 ounces. Now let's say that you are constipated for whatever reason and you need a laxative. The average American, 95% of all Americans, will go for their chemical laxative. That is not a good idea. Because guess what is the number one cause of constipation in the United States? The overuse of laxatives. Instead, how about using rye? R-Y-E, that's correct, the grain, rye. Here is the latest in the Journal of Nutrition done at the University of Helsinki. Quote, rye beats laxatives for constipation relief. Consumption of a fiber-rich rye bread may ease constipation and perform better than commercial laxative, according to this new study. Quote, to the best of our knowledge, this study is the first to evaluate the effects of rye bread in treating constipation as compared to laxatives and to simultaneously investigate the changes in the colonic metabolism. The results are very encouraging. So, that's good news. You can use rye. And finally, the gut microflora in diabetes. Studies suggest role of pro and prebiotics. This is from PLOS One, a major scientific journal, published in the University of Copenhagen's review, and here's what it says. Bacterial populations in the gut of diabetics differ from non-diabetics, says a new study from Denmark that may open up a potential role to modify gut microflora with probiotics and prebiotics to improve health. Now, what does this mean? It means that the average American is consuming a lot of very unhealthy, non-fibrous foods. Meats, cheeses have no fiber, but they do have bacteria. And the bacteria manifest in the gut and create a very toxic medium inside the gut. The good news is that when you're taking healthy fibers, both modified citrus pectin, which is very good, and blueberry, which is outstanding because the skin creates a nice gelatinous coating and it moves the food through the gastrointestinal tract. And then you add in things like L-glycine, a couple thousand milligrams, and the aloe vera, which turns off inflammation from Crohn's disease, nelioitis, and colitis, and diverticulitis. Throw in some caprylic acid from grapeseed extract, which helps kill off a lot of those pesky parasites. Put in some vitamin C that helps heal the lining of the intestine, and then get off that meat-based diet. There's no reason you can't have a completely normal digestion. No more bloating, gas, constipation, diarrhea, distension. All that is a thing of the past. I'm Gary Null. That's our Health and Nutrition Report. Back in a moment. Please stay with us. I'd like to welcome all of you. I'm Gary Null. We're broadcasting live today from our new studios and our offices in New York City. We welcome everyone. A couple of issues from our environmental section, which is an important part of our program. First up, I've been saying for a long time, I've been working on our documentary on the 12 tipping points now for about 7 years, that one of our biggest concerns is the fact that because of global warming, and it really is irrelevant whether you think global warming is man-made or not man-made. It's happening. That's why you have the worst droughts in our history and the worst cold and the longest warm winter. And all these freaky accidents in nature, these are all caused by global warming. But my biggest concern is that in time, the three largest bodies of frozen water, which would be Greenland, about three times the size of Texas, and Antarctica, the size of France and Spain combined. If Greenland thaws and the water goes from Greenland into the ocean. There is only one ocean. Yes, we have the Pacific Ocean, the Atlantic Ocean, the Indian Ocean. No, we don't. There's only one ocean in the world. That is the ocean, of which we define, depending upon where it's located, we give it a localized name. But when the water starts to rise, it rises universally. Because there is so much water in the world, you have to melt a lot of ice in order for that water to rise. The problem is, it's been rising, and only now through satellite imaging are we able to actually see how this rise is occurring. If Greenland were to melt completely, it would increase the water by 20 feet. If we lost the water as ice, and or it became water from ice melting in Antarctica, it would raise it at least another 100 feet or more. But it doesn't happen all at once. But it's happening faster than any mathematical model projected. Here is the latest on this. And this is, again, from eScience. And this is from the Potsdam Institute for Climate Impact Research and the University in Madrid. It says the following: Greenland ice sheet may melt completely with a 1.6 degree global warming. Now think of that for a moment. I'll quote directly from them. The Greenland ice sheet is likely to be more vulnerable to global warming than previously thought. The temperature threshold for melting the ice sheet completely is in the range of 0.8 to 3.2 degrees Celsius of global warming, with the best estimate of 1.6 degrees above pre-industrial levels. That's according to a new study by scientists, and that's not a big change. So we are seeing radical increases in the temperature. And it's catch 22. As long as the Arctic and the whole area of the Arctic is frozen, and as long as the tundra and over much of Russia and Iceland and Canada and Alaska stays permafrost, frozen, that's good. But it's not now. It's melting. And each summer, more and more of the ice melts back. That allows the sun to go through the water, and it's shallow. It's only about 300 to 500 feet there. Hits that, starts to warm up that frozen soil, and methane gas escapes. It also means that normally the sun hits the ice and it bounces back in the atmosphere. That's no problem. But when there's no ice, it hits the rock, warms up the rock, melts more ice going up the rock, hits the water, warms up the water, changes the current, changes everything. So now in the next 10 years, I predict we will see a substantial melting with massive calving. That's where you've seen a picture where a giant piece of ice breaks off and falls into the water with a big splash. I believe we will see this accelerated at levels never before seen, which means that the people living within 20 miles of the ocean will be impacted. Why? Because for every foot that the water increases, you lose between 100 to 1,000 feet of land. And some cities, including New York City, be flooded. And not the buildings, but the underground, which case your electricity, your gas, your sewage, your subways, all gone. Washington, D.C., because it's at sea level, right off the Chesapeake, fed by the Potomac, that would be affected. South Beach, Miami, clear up the East Coast, affected. We're talking about nearly one-third of the American population would be impacted. But then again, think of major cities that are right on the water. They'd be affected. So just be aware that this is happening, and absolutely nothing is being done, and no one's addressing it. Next up, the FDA's huge conflict of interest with Big Pharma. I'm concerned that the FDA no longer serves the real interest of keeping our food supply safe and the medicines checked to make sure that they are effective beyond a placebo, substantially beyond, and that they're not going to have adverse effects. But now we've seen that is not the case. Let me offer this from the Alliance for Natural Health. I'll quote it. It's short but important. The FDA's huge conflict of interest, Big Pharma. Tragically, the drug they endorsed is killing the women who take it. Why is the FDA doing this? The birth control pills Yaz and Yasmin which were endorsed by the FDA Advisory Committee last December, contain a drug that is deadly. Women who take it are nearly 700% more likely to develop thromboembolism, which, by the way, is an obstruction of a blood vessel by a blood clot, which can cause deep vein thrombosis, pulmonary embolism, stroke, heart attack, and death, compared to women who do not take any contraceptive pill, and twice the risk of women who take a different form of contraceptive. Thousands of women have filed a lawsuit against the Bayer company, saying they were injured by Yaz or Yasmin. Why would the FDA approve such a dangerous drug? An investigation by Washington Monthly and the British Medical Journal found that, here's what's important, at least four members of the advisory FDA committee that approves the drugs have either done work for the drug manufacturers or licensees or receive research funding from them. The members reported that the industry ties to FDA, but the FDA decided it didn't matter and didn't make the disclosures public. Each of those four panelists who received money from the pill's manufacturer voted in favor of the pill. Interestingly, the committee's ruling that the drug's benefit outweighs the risk was decided by a 4-point margin. Ironically, while the FDA allowed voting by advisors with business and financial connections to the drug, the agency barred the single voice who was opposed to it, Dr. Sidney Wolfe, who I met recently. There was a benefit for a public citizen, and Sidney Wolfe was there, and I filmed Sidney Wolfe for several of our documentaries, including Prescription for Disaster. He is truly a person on the side of the public and protecting us from dangerous drugs. And why did they not allow Dr. Wolfe to vote? Because they said he had an intellectual conflict of interest, because 6 years ago, he advised the FDA not to take Yaz based upon several years of data, and that he had published on that. Because he had predetermined years ago that it was an unsafe drug, they now took the one person who believed it was an unsafe drug off the panel. This is the nonsense that goes on at the FDA. But it gets more interesting. The FDA also did not provide the panel with recently unsealed court documents revealing that former FDA Commissioner David Kessler, who I had on this program recently, had accused Bayer of hiding data on blood clot risks associated with Yaz and Yasmin. Dr. Kessler also reported that they were paid $450,000 to just one high-profile gynecologist to sponsor the pill, including off-label use, during a book tour. Bayer, of course, has a strong vested interest in getting endorsements for Yaz and Yasmin. It was their top-selling birth control pill in the United States. Now, this is not the first time an FDA advisory panel has recommended an unsafe drug. Remember Vioxx that killed 60 million Americans? Also, how about an FDA committee endorsed the weight loss drug Cunexa, a diet pill that had documented risk of causing birth defects and heart problems? And the conflicts of interest don't stop with the government bodies. They also are rampant among medical professionals of all kinds. Drug companies pay doctors, researchers, and medical experts for speaking engagements and consulting fees. Now, how much do you get paid if you're a doctor going to lecture? And let's say your lecture is then given credit as continuing education medical credit. Now, I've actually been a lecturer for continuing education credit for doctors, and I accept no money. They get anywhere from $3,000 to $5,000 per lecture, and these are not long lectures. But what if you line up and you have a week and you do five lectures a day to a group? Well, you just made yourself a lot of money, all from the manufacturer of a particular pill, and always with the idea that you're going to be promoting that approach. Now, also, I'll be going out on the road in another few days. I'll be out there for some time. Most of my journey will be traveling from city to city around the United States. I intend to hit about 22 cities. I want to talk with senior citizens. I believe that with 90 million Americans now over the age of 47, and with 10,000 people becoming senior citizens every single day, we are ill-prepared to understand the consequences of our actions and what to do, especially with health. So this is a research journey I'll be filming to see how are people coping? What could they do better? What power do they have to make healthy choices? Who's helping them? Who's advocating for them? And it'll be an interesting look, because I'm finding from my preliminary research that millions of Americans who had worked in different positions for several decades and retired either with a pension or, if they were old enough, Social Security and a pension, now are being hammered because their pensions are being reduced or eliminated altogether. And this is something we're not talking about, but we should. This is some global research, and it's short, but it's important we know this. Quote, vanishing pensions all over America, old age pensions are being slashed or eliminated. How would you feel if you worked for a state or local government for 30 years only to have your pension slashed dramatically or taken away entirely? Well, this exact scenario is playing out from coast to coast, and the years ahead, millions of Americans are going to be affected by broken promises and vanishing pensions. In the old days, things were much different. You would get hired by a big company or a government institution, and you knew that the retirement benefits that you were promised you would have when you retired in a few decades. Unfortunately, we have now arrived at that time when government institutions and big companies have promised far more than they are able to deliver, and pension reform has become one of the hot button issues all over the nation. Many Americans that have been basing their financial futures on their pensions are waking up one day and finding that their pensions are either gone or have been cut back dramatically. According to Northwestern University Professor John Rowe, the latest estimate of the total amount of unfunded pensions and obligations by just the local and state governments, we're not talking about federal now, is $4.4 trillion. That's $4.4 trillion. America is continually becoming a poor nation, and all that money is simply not going to magically materialize somewhere. So where is the $4.4 trillion going to come from? Well, either pension benefits are going to be cut substantially or eliminated completely. There is simply not enough money out there to keep all of the pension commitments that have been made. Something has to give. In the end, millions of elderly Americans will likely be plunged in poverty. Some local governments around the nation have already declared bankruptcy and are either eliminating pensions or cutting them very deeply. Just check out what just happened in Central Falls, Rhode Island. For years, city officials promised robust union contracts and pensions without raising revenue to pay for them. Last August, the math caught up with them. Central Falls was broke, its pension fund short $46 million, it declared bankruptcy. Quote, my daughters grew up here, went to school here, it's all gone, said Mike Jeffrey, a retired firefighter. He said he could not make the payments on his house after his pension was cut $1,100 a month. When will the math catch up with the other cities around the United States? It's catching up now. So shouldn't we have a national debate on what to do about understanding more constructive, creative, and progressive ways of helping people keep from going into poverty, because the seniors don't have the advantage that younger people have. Younger people have their lives ahead of them, whether they're challenged financially or not. What happens if you're 70 years old and you live in a home where you're a widow, you cannot pay for your rent or mortgage, your electricity, your food, your medicine? You can't pay for it all. It just doesn't stretch. What do you do? Those people suffer in silence, and it's time that we gave them a voice and brought their story to you. That's why I'll be on the road filming the story of Americans who are aging and facing challenges. Otherwise, what do we see on television? If you're an older person on television, we see you having problems. Mom and dad have got Alzheimer's, but thank God for this drug that helps them. Or I can't go out anywhere because I have urinary incontinence, and so we show the leaky plumbing thing. Or you've got arthritis, or you can't keep up the way you used to. We only show a debilitated way of aging. We don't show vitalism. We don't show how many people are able to be magnificently healthy and even healthier, stronger, faster as they age. Why don't we see Sid Howard and Sam Skinner and Joan Rowland and Queenie Thompson, the people who I know, who are all world-class athletes, who they have an energy an 18-year-old couldn't keep up with. We won't show them, because once you show that there's a different model of aging, then a lot of people are going to say, what? You mean I don't have to have? No, you don't. Then watch the tagline in every one of those ads showing an older person who's getting some help. It's always with a drug that really never helps. So we're going to deal with this, because people are confused, they feel abandoned, the government doesn't help them, the states don't help them, and unfortunately the American public is just not aware how it is affecting them. We'll bring you that story. Back in a moment with my guest. My guest is coming up in a moment to talk about the relationship between the food and the quality of food we eat and social class and corporate dominance of food supply, Tracy McMillan. And by the way, she's a former investigative reporter from New York who is focused on poverty and welfare issues. And she's written for the New York Times, Harper, Slate, and she was the managing editor of the City Limits magazine. And she's been recognized for her work by World Hunger Year and James Beard Foundation. And her most recent work has been an important firsthand investigation into food access in America and the relationship between food and social and economic status. Her recent book is The American Way of Eating, Undercover at Walmart, Applebee's, Farm Fields, and the Dinner Table. And it recounts her year of diving into the trenches of migrant labor on farms, working in fast food kitchens as an employee of Walmart's, all the while trying to survive on the same salaries and work conditions as the subjects of her book. Back in a moment with that story. Please stay with us.
You know you make me wanna shout, kick my heels up and shout, throw my hands up and shout, throw my head back and shout. Come on now, don't forget to say you will. Don't forget to say yeah, 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 yeah.
Say you will.
Say it right now, baby.
Say you will.
Come on, man, come on.
Say you will.
Say it better, yeah.
You will.
Come on now.
Say
that.
I'd like to welcome all of you. I'm Gary Null, broadcasting from our brand new studios in New York City. And if you want to watch today's program, you can, as well as listen to it. And with the new studio, we'll be able to play you excerpts, including starting tomorrow. First and foremost, thank all of you who joined us for our march, the 6 mile march, with the Buddhist priests who were drumming to honor, we want to honor all of the victims of Fukushima. They were brought over here to the United States. They were leading the march to the ceremonies they give. And then to all the speakers who came in front of Indian Point, we had a memorable day. I had three different film crews there. Our reporters were there. We covered it. We've edited together a relatively short but very insightful 13-minute film. We'll show it to you tomorrow on this program. Then next week, while I'm on the road, I will show you why I'm opposed to the official environmental organizations. With the exception of Greenpeace, I'm challenging all of them. And you'll see a speech I made at the UN as a keynote speaker last year on Earth Day about how the environmental movement has sold out its constituent and why we need a renaissance of grassroots movement. Well, Indian Point, it was all grassroots movement. Watch how we organized, how well everyone, how articulate they did, how well we did in giving our message to the governor, to the New York State legislators, and all the media were there. Fox, everybody was there. Everybody was giving a story. Harvey Wasserman, who, along with Carl Grossman, have done more to close America's nuclear power plants, they've closed two, than anyone else. And Harvey is helping lead a movement to close the Yankee nuclear power plant in Vermont. He feels that they have a chance of getting it closed in the next couple of weeks, at least not allowing it to be continuing operations. It'll be shut down. But it has to be organized. It has to start somewhere. I'm going to show you that tomorrow, and then I'm going to show you our environmental movement program next week, and a lot more to come. I might mention I was very pleased with all the people who showed up, and we asked who showed up. I feel it's unfortunate that no one from Pacifica, no one from BAI's management, producer, staff, chose to participate in something that's important. My hope is that in the future, they'll realize that these are also challenging the whole radiation potential leaks, challenging genetically engineered food, challenging gas hydrofracking, challenging the issue that our veterans have been abandoned, these many other issues. These are also important. The American people think so, and 11 out of 11 major events that we sponsored, rallies, marches, demonstrations in front of the White House, there hadn't been a single person from the station who showed up. Let us hope that they find some measure of empathy with these causes and actually make the time. Everybody's got an excuse except the people who show up. So let's hope that there is some participation, even if one person at the station, a producer, a programmer, one person, I'd be happy. Thus far, we've had zero. By the way, if you want to listen to our programs over the telephone, you can now. Our number is 832-280-0066, 832-280-0066. Nice to have you with us today, Tracy.
Thanks so much for having me.
Tracy, for anyone who does international travel, particularly in the developing world, I find it interesting to observe an inverse in diets and food preferences between the rich and poor. In India, in the Philippines, and Nigeria, you will frequently find that it is the higher economic strata of the population who will go to McDonald's or a fast food outlet because they can afford it, compared to the poor people who eat more wholesome traditional meals, higher in agricultural produce, although perhaps unable to afford the variety of produce, many which are extremely expensive. But they get their essential foods as they have done for hundreds of years. In Western countries, on the other hand, particularly the United States, it is just the opposite. It is the wealthy and better off who have the luxury to shop at a Whole Foods mega store and pay the extra money for their organic produce. And it's the people at the lower end of America's social chain who are stuck eating a junk food meal or in restaurants, heavily processed canned vegetables and almost nothing fresh. So after putting yourself in the nitty-gritty of our food industry and farming and investigating the path of food from the farm to the shelves to the supermarket to the fast food chains, give us the insights that you saw in your investigation and hit on all the important highlights.
Okay, that's a quick question. Talking about sort of how food works in other places, right, you know, I've been lucky enough to travel internationally. I too had noticed this, you know, when you're in a country that's not industrialized the way the U.S. is, you know, lower-income families and the poorest folks are usually eating very traditional foods, whereas the convenience foods are considered, you know, a sign of economic progress. And so, you know, I think it's important to remember that convenience and that time is really important to folks and not to sort of begrudge people trying to make room in their lives for, you know, stuff that's more fun than just cooking. So, you know, one of the things that I really noticed changing in me, you know, I'm someone who has always enjoyed and liked cooking very much. And when I was working on the night shift at Walmart, you know, your day sort of shrinks when you're on the night shift and you get a few hours of daylight here and that's about it. And I found that I really resented that I needed to spend that time cooking in the kitchen. And particularly because I was very, very poor at that point. I had, you know, I had made this very middle-class decision early on when I started that particular job that I was going to buy a bunch of food in bulk and then be able to eat off of it because this would be a way to save money. And what I did is I tied up all of my income essentially in grain. So I had, you know, I had a lot of oats, I had a lot of flour, had a lot of rice. I didn't have a lot else to eat, and I ran out of money to pay my rent, in part because I had spent so much money on the bulk stuff. And, you know, when it gets to the point where you say, well, I'm either going to go hungry or I'm going to bake bread, baking bread doesn't feel like so much fun anymore. I feel like I gained a lot more respect and appreciation for what that kind of convenience food probably means for families, you know, that traditionally have had to work really hard to feed themselves. You know, and certainly here in the U.S., you do see a problem that nutritionists refer to as the Americanization of diet, right? So very recent immigrants still have a lot of food literacy from their traditional country. They know a lot about picking produce and things like that. So say in the Flatbush neighborhood in Brooklyn, there's a lot of little green markets full of fresh produce, and you see ladies in there, squeezing and checking the ripeness of food. And that was also something that when I worked at Walmart, I realized that I didn't really know that much about how to select for good produce, which was ironic given that I was working in a produce section. So all of that, I think, for me, I came to realize, right, that it's not just a question of economics, but time and convenience and work life as well, that shapes how people eat.
Okay, one of my greatest concerns is food turning into a traded commodity for banker casino gambling. And while we do not witness its impact as much in the United States compared to developing countries, I feel certain we will eventually experience it as the bounty of our food declines for a wide variety of reasons: soil depletion, global warming, over pesticide use giving rise to smaller yields, the threat of industrial monocrop farming due to genetically modified seeds. And all these conditions are just profit for investor sharks. This raises a topic you focus on from a different perspective, and that is the relationship between the quality of food we have, what is affordable, our class warfare. So I'd like for you to expand on this relationship between food and social class. In what ways is it a serious social threat to nutrition and diet, and what are some of the solutions that you feel are necessary?
Sure. So the relationship between food and class, right, obviously is a very complicated one. And one thing that I was really interested to see is that there does tend to be this assumption that low-income families in the U.S. are eating tons and tons of junk food. Very low-income families, they might be buying junk food at the store. They're not going out to McDonald's. There was actually a study recently looking at who was buying fast food, and it was actually more middle-class families. Because those are the folks who can afford to pay for that. Eating out at McDonald's might be cheap compared to going out to a high-end restaurant, but it's actually usually not that cheap compared to what you can prepare at home. Whether or not what you can prepare at home is going to have a lot of fruits and vegetables in it, which is sort of the big dietary stumbling block in the U.S., like, that's a different question. Americans right now, I think it's 80% of Americans do not consume the recommended daily allowance of fruits and vegetables. And here in the U.S., we only grow about half the fruits and vegetables that would be required for everyone to meet the recommended daily allowance. So I think, it's really important to keep in mind, sort of the quality specifically of our diet. In terms of broader food commodity stuff, one thing that I was really trying to do with the American way of eating was to interrogate this idea that the way that we change the food system, the way that we change our agriculture, the way that we change the American diet is by telling people to pay more money for a higher quality product, which has been most of the focus for a lot of food writing, which I think is perfectly fine for a certain economic class of folks. But when I was doing my research on sort of how diet and food worked in terms of socioeconomic class, I was really surprised to find that, while I think it's the national average for how much of our budget goes to food is about 10 to 12%. Most Americans' families spend 10 to 12% of their budgets on food as an average, but that differs dramatically according to socioeconomic class, which is, in hindsight, that's perfectly logical. But, the top third of American families, which are the families earning $70,000 a year or more, they're spending about 8 or 9% of their income on food. The bottom third, which are families earning $35,000 a year or less, spend between a quarter and more than a third of their income on food. So that's a really different kind of argument to make around food if someone's already spending more than a third of their income on it, as opposed to someone who's spending 8 or 9%. And so I thought that was really interesting. And then the other thing that I found very fascinating was that when you look at average food spending across the different socioeconomic strata, low-income families are spending just about the same amount of their food budgets on fruits and vegetables as our higher-income families. Like, you really only see a differentiation in dollar spending of fruits and vegetables once you get up to the top third. So everybody below that $70,000 mark is spending between $12 and $14 a week on produce, whether they're very poor, or sort of more solidly middle class. And to me, that was really interesting because you hear this idea that, poor people are just eating a lot of junk food, and they're arguably sort of prioritizing fruits and vegetables on average more than other families in terms of the share of their spending they're dedicating to it.
I appreciate those insights, Tracy. Just a final note here. I intend to challenge Walmart, and I intend to challenge all the thoughts we have, because I'm going to open up a store in one of the low-income neighborhoods called a Poor People Store. That's my working title, where all the food in that store will be both organic and natural, and it'll be inexpensive. Not because we're giving it away, but because to show you that we have not understood how to make healthy foods affordable, and people have to know that you can eat like they do in India. The pulses and the legumes and the grains and the beans, these are not expensive. I just believe that the average American is out of the loop on what actually it costs to buy a good meal, then showing them how to prepare it, even having cooking classes, shopping classes. I believe that we have not taken this step. It does not exist now anywhere in the United States, and we're going to do it just to prove once and for all that we have to open a whole new door of awareness, that if you're on a limited income, you should not have to think that you can only buy junk food because you can't afford any other. I'm going to show people that they can be healthy. They just don't have to buy the designer foods that are in a Whole Foods. And that's the future, and that's going to happen in the near future. And I really appreciate your book and the work you did out there, and all the best to you in your efforts to educate Americans on this topic, the American way of eating. Thank you, Tracy.
Great. Thanks so much.
I'm Gary Null. Now, every day I'm trying to show you of something of concern to me and many other Americans, that we are quickly losing our rights, and we should pay attention to this and how it manifests. This is just one example of something that is concern and what all of us, irrespective of our political backgrounds or leanings, should feel about it. I'll get back to this in just a moment with your calls. Watch this clip.
The U.S. government now laying out its... Holder said, he said, there is due process, but there is not due juris something or other.
Judicial process.
Not judicial process.
What the Attorney General said, let me make his argument. His argument is that there is a substituted form of due process. that if the president and his advisors carefully consider the danger of a human being and conclude that that human being needs to be stopped before that person causes any more danger, then the president can kill him. That's their argument. There is no case law that stands for that. There is no statute that authorizes it, and it directly defies the Fifth Amendment to the Constitution.
Sounds like a crime against humanity. What's the difference between that and what Bashar al-Assad is doing to his own people? What is the difference?
Nothing. What's the difference between killing somebody, an American, with a drone in Yemen and killing an American with a drone in Peoria? Nothing.
Right.
Same argument that Eric Holder made at the Northwestern Law School on Tuesday about Al-Awlaki in Yemen could be made about somebody in Peoria tomorrow.
You make an illegal lane change in Hollywood on the 101 freeway and a drone will just shoot you out of the sky and throw you, you know, bury you.
Well, I don't know that it's going to
I don't know either, but who'd have thought we'd ever get to hear?
Who would have thought that we'd even be having a conversation like this, that the attorney, that the head of the FBI would hesitate to answer a question that is so imbued in our history and our law and our values, due process precedes punishment, that he can't answer that in public?
And we're worried about contraception.
Correct. Correct. We do not have our priorities straight. The last time the federal government claimed that it could kill Americans was in the Civil War. And even Lincoln said it could only be done in during combat. This federal government, this administration, says it can kill Americans when they're riding with their children in a car in a desert.
I don't know, Judge. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Keep watching them, please.
Of course. Thanks for having me.
I'm very concerned that this is not being discussed vigorously, what it means to have a country that is now held captive to a Defense Appropriation Act. Here are some of the other erosion of our individual rights that I believe we should be discussing. To gather and express free speech rights near government and federal locations. Right now, you could be arrested and spend a year in jail for that. Abuse of the Patriot Act, detention and arrest of citizens not involved in direct terrorism connections. The growth of the surveillance state, meaning they're collecting massive data on citizens. Warrantless wiretapping, abuse of the material witness statute, holding people indefinitely without charge. The NADD, U.S. military, is a domestic policing department contrary to all constitutional warnings. The internet piracy issue, the internet privacy, personal information, including your past history, financial information, which the government can now get all of that. The Real ID Act and national card system connected with federal justice and intelligence agencies are trying to pass. So every American would have to have an ID card, and on that ID card would be a retinal scan. And also now, that card would allow them, if they chose, to track you everywhere you are, and to also be able to impact if you got on an airplane, if you got on a bus, if you wanted to take money out of a bank, and if you took money out of the bank, how much money you took. Why is that the business of anyone except yourself? But now they've made it their business. The erosion of academic freedom, preventing scholars critical of the U.S. from traveling abroad, and censorship of the news and science and research. The erosion of rights of safe drinking water and food and welfare and health care through corporatizing a government legislation. Rights of having information of products and services that are toxic, and yet you are attacked for getting that information. The rights to vaccinate are not. In many states, for philosophical or religious reasons, sometimes you don't have that right to exclude a vaccination. The food safety bill and preventing individuals to grow their own produce. They're now trying to prevent individuals from growing their own produce unless you use their genetically engineered seed. The assurance that the state and religion are in fact separate, and yet there's taxpayer funding of religious initiatives. The ability of the public to hold corporations, banks, elected officials, political parties, and media networks accountable for fraud, lies, and criminal activity. Yet we have no rights to that. And personal choice and availability of medical treatment, not recognized by the American Medical Association. And finally, human right violations in American prisons and increasing the creed guilty until proven innocent in our justice system. Those are just some of the reasons I believe that we should listen to the issues that Mr. Judge Napolitano are raising on our militarization of our country and the erosion of our personal rights. Those are my thoughts. For those of you that only carry part of our program, we thank you for listening. For those of you who continue to listen and watch over the internet, we will continue for another few moments. Joining in studio is Dr. Nadia. She's a graduate of Albert Einstein School of Medicine and Yeshiva University, and she is here because according to our previous guest, a lot of Americans think that if you're poor or in the lower income, you can only buy junk foods. And yet you help people understand how to shop for healthy foods. What percentage of the people that you work with, poor or middle class or even wealthy, don't know how to shop at all for healthy food?
Well, Gary, thanks for asking me on. And probably about 80% of the customers that come in every day. So I see an average of 15 people a day. I would say about 9 or 10 of them, maybe even more.
Simply don't know how to shop.
They don't know how to shop, and they assume that if they're buying organic, it's going to be a lot more expensive. And they're very surprised that it's not, especially when we start talking about buying in bulk and preparing ahead of time.
What are some of the choices that you encourage people to buy in the way of grains for their family or product, like beans, that would help give them better nutrition than what they were eating before and also help reverse and prevent disease?
Well, I'll give you an example. There was a gentleman by the name of Peter who's come in to see me a few times, and we decided together that he was going to switch over and go completely organic, gluten-free, and no animal proteins. So we came up with a budget, and we decided that if he ordered in bulk from the store, it doesn't have to be, it could be from any store, that he would end up saving a lot of money. So we looked at things like lentils, black beans, pinto beans, brown rice, quinoa, barley, and then all sorts of different nuts so he can get his proteins in that way, almonds, cashews, walnuts.
How much money did he save from what he was spending before?
He ended up paying about 25 cents on the dollar.
So that's
versus
a
big savings.
Big savings.
Yeah, versus if he had bought it canned or prepared.
One of the arguments I've used in showing people how to shop, and I do this all the time, is I'll take a potato and I'll say, here is an organic potato.
Yeah.
First, it only takes about up to 60 gallons of water to have it grow.
Right.
And it's about 85 cents. Compare that with a pound of meat that takes over 12,000 gallons of water. And then compare the price of the meat, which is five times higher than the potato.
Right.
And yet you're getting alpha lipoic acid in the potato and protein and calcium magnesium. I also have taken people down to the area of Manhattan, Little India, where there are about six stores. And the moment you walk in the door, you have these wonderful aromas that you don't smell elsewhere. And they have over 100 different types of curry spices. The average American's unaware of these, and yet they're medicinal and as well as being flavorful, and you can buy things for 75 cents a pound.
Yeah.
Do you encourage people to go to farmers markets,
Absolutely.
Food co-ops?
All the time. Farmers markets to get their greens, food co-ops to get their spices. We talk about ginger and garlic and curcumin and turmeric and all those things.
Good. Yeah. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. You're welcome.
I'm interested in proving or disproving a notion. I believe that in every city in the United States, we should have a store that specializes in inexpensive, organic, wholesome foods for people who choose to eat healthy and save money. We have not done this. I believe that once you show it can be done, that then this will be the place that so many people will go to. They'll stop eating the junk food, they'll stop eating the fast food, and they'll start transitioning over a period of time into healthier selections for no other reason than because if you're diabetic, if you're overweight, if you have high blood pressure, elevated cholesterol, natural foods help bring that down. Spices, seasonings, turmeric, and garlic and ginger help bring that down. I believe that will be the future, and I'm going to implement that in the near future. Thank you all very much for watching and listening. I appreciate your support of this program. We look forward to sharing more tomorrow. Have a nice day, everyone.
You better stop, If you don't stop,